Jessica, hi. Happy to have you with me.
Thanks for having me.
So, I don't think you need an introduction, but if you could say what you do.
So I'm Jessica Tams, and I'm the managing director of the CGA. And we have a couple of things that we do that people know us by better, which is Casual Connect. We also organize Indie Prize, which is a scholarship program for up-and-coming developers. We have a news outlet, GameSauce. And we've been doing this for 13 years. We do 4 shows a year, 3 parties a show. So that's what I do. We plan parties.
Nice job, huh?
Yeah, nice job.
And you're so good at it. So let's talk a little bit about Jessica. Who's Jessica behind the title?
I used to be always go, go, go. So, you know, not stop. I was an overachiever, so as I was doing my homework.
That's what the, you're an A student?
Yes, A student. Over like technically, you know, storybook overachiever student. So that's what I used to babysit some little kids, and when we were older I came in, you know, they came back and they said, you know, what do you remember about Jessica? And they told their mom, Jessica was always working, and that was me. So So I guess it's the same.
Impressive. Yeah. Well, I guess you know, like you had a good school back then,
yeah.
And now you never stop. Did you do any sports in school? Was it just studying mainly?
No, self-driven sports. So I'd go run, or I'd lift weights, played a little soccer, but never any team sports.
You didn't find yourself in there comfortable, or is it just you didn't really want?
Didn't do that, no. Because stereotypical overachiever in school, not in sports.
Yeah, they say you can do anything, not everything, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So that's amazing. You travel a lot, mostly to Casual Connects because they're so spread around the world. Do you travel for vacation a lot?
No.
Or is it like the time that you prefer?
At home. Yeah. So. A couple of years ago, I moved back to Utah, which is where I grew up, and I lived next to my parents for a while so they could help with, you know, the kids, because I now have a baby, and they helped take care of my house, which is nice.
Yeah.
And then maybe just this last year, no, 2 years ago, we moved up to our farm that we had acquired a couple of years ago. And so we lived in like this storybook, I don't know.
We live in vacation.
Like, there's trees all over. We live right next to public land. We have about 200 acres for the farm. Mm-hmm. And so it's like being on vacation every day. So you wake up and you look out, and it's kind of a view like this. You're up on the mountainside. And so there's deer running around. We have, you know, we'll see at least a dozen deer a day. And we have turkeys that come through the property. So there's maybe 50 to 100 turkeys that come through. Like wild turkeys, not like regular turkeys. Yeah, and we have horses, neighbors have cows. It's all pretty, it's like being on holiday, so.
Yeah, well that explains a lot. When you live in a
holiday. There's no reason to go.
For sure. Did you ever think like moving anywhere, maybe when you were younger? Did you ever consider like maybe going to a different country? To live.
I took French in high school, and so I always thought I wanted to go visit France, but I never thought I wanted to live in France. But I wanted to visit France. I don't visit France a lot now. It's like ironic, I guess. But other than that, not really. There was never a thought that I should go out and move somewhere else. But I like people from other countries, and I like visiting them.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do travel, I don't like typical holidays sitting on the beach. I like to go see people that I know and then have the people that I know go and show me what is like the real city. So you come in here and you see the real Kyiv, right? You see the real Amsterdam. How do normal people live?
Not the tourist life.
Not the tourist life. So where do people eat, like normal people eat? Where do normal people shop? And what is that experience? Because often I think when we go into the city, you know, even mentioning like coming to Amsterdam or Paris or London, The experience is the same in every single big city. The museums are laid out the same. They have the same structure. You walk through, they share exhibits with each other. They're kind of the same. But if you go into a city like Dresden or a smaller city, and then you come in on, you know, like kind of the less tourist angle, like the experience is very different. And so for me, that's something that I personally like a lot better. So the smaller cities that have a lot of history, like Kyiv is a good example. Kyiv doesn't have like the standard tourist experience in its museums or in its tours. So you go and you have a tour of like the World War II Museum, and it's not going to the standard tourist experience. It's very localized.
Yeah. You mentioned food. Would you call yourself foodie? Do you like to eat and try things, or do you like to cook more? You cook.
I like to cook because I like the food I cook, and I don't like to eat
gross food.
And I have a slightly sensitive stomach for some things, so it's like I can't eat fast food, chips, they make me sick. Movie popcorn makes me sick. I guess I'm lucky because I never got into a soda chip habit ever in my entire life because it makes me so sick. But yeah, I like the different foods. And there's, I like it. When I went, I actually spoke in a conference in Japan, and I was the only, of course, the only person from outside of Japan. And so they give us some bento boxes, and they're like just typical Japanese bento boxes that they would eat because it was just what they were serving.
Well, what's inside?
And they said, and it's, you know, like Japanese, they eat well-prepared, small, like I would say, like parts of fish, you know, and then some different flavors that most Americans would eat. And so they were really worried that I wouldn't eat anything inside of that bento box, but I was like, okay, I'm gonna eat the whole thing. So I ate every single piece in my bento box, and they were very surprised. they didn't think that I was gonna eat anything.
Did you like it, or did you?
Yeah. There's some things I don't like, but pretty much I'll eat anything. I had liver last night at dinner.
Well, did you try solo?
Yes, I had that, but I did not have that last night. But yeah, last night, like it's a very Ukrainian dish to have liver. And so when I tell people we go to Ukraine and we serve a lunch, and this lunch, sometimes we serve liver, they're like, you serve people liver? I'm like, yeah, because people in Ukraine, they eat liver and it's fine. You know, I eat liver at home. But in America, I would say that maybe like 90% of the population has maybe even never had liver.
Do your kids eat everything that you cook?
No.
Picky?
I would say they're picky, but they don't always eat everything. But when I cook, it's like one of these kid tactics, I guess, is while you're cooking, if you put out fruits and vegetables on the table, and people are snacking, like they'll snack on carrot sticks and celery, right?
Yeah.
And fruit and whatnot. And they'll eat it then, and then you serve dinner, and then they'll get all the fruits and vegetables and their dinner. And so I always try and serve like 5 to 6 different fruits and vegetables. Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, you bribe the kids.
What do you think, this is not your first time to Kyiv.
No, this is.
Do you see it's changed over the years?
Yeah, a lot.
What is like the most remarkable thing that you can call out?
I would say when we first came to Kyiv initially, we came in like the very first year that we came. It was when the visas were opened up for Westerners, for Europe and for the United States, and they had opened up the visas a couple months before we actually had our Kyiv show. So we planned the Kyiv show and finalized the location earlier in the year, and then we were able to, you know, finalize it and say, okay, we're going to go to Kyiv, they have these open pieces, everything's fine, it's going to be amazing, everybody. So you come in off the plane, and there's border control, and it's this big, huge mass of people who don't want to stand in line, right, of course, and they're just like all crowding, big thing, like a couple guards up front, and they don't speak any English at the time. There's nobody who spoke English in the airport. And we had prepared letters in Ukrainian and Russian and English saying who we were, what we were doing there. And so you just hand them the letter, and they read it, and they look at you, and, you know, and they're very concerned. And they were very concerned for a long time. and it was like free fall and a little, you know, I guess scary almost, right? Because it's not like an airport in the States and you go through border control, you know, and then you come out of the terminal and there's all these taxi drivers yelling at you. Like, they're not even taxi drivers, private drivers. You know? There's no taxi system. So we always had to arrange for somebody to pick up all the Westerners if they weren't from Russia or Ukraine, for their safety, of course.
Yeah.
And now, when we come into Ukraine, for Americans or people from the West, they come in very orderly, everybody speaks English. We don't prepare documents for them. Now we prepare documents for the Russians, not for the Americans. There's an Uber here, you know, negotiating with a taxi driver when you don't know Russian or Ukrainian is very difficult and possible. And so Uber has really made Kyiv a lot more accessible, I think, for people like me. I never took a taxi before there was Uber. I would walk for an hour to avoid having to take a taxi. And now, obviously, I can order my own Uber. It's fine. Although I do prefer to walk, but I will order the Uber. So that's, I would say, the biggest change is just like the structural change, corruption. Nobody's asking for bribes. That's nice.
No, it's really, you know, good to have this perspective and view. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. It was great.